Let's hope this works.
Today's poker tip of the day. Start reading the dictionary before you go out and play next session. So when an idiot scoops a massive pot off of you with 6-4 offsuit, you can call him a didactic hemorrhoidal fucktard. Nothing tilts more than a high vocabulary.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho, O, H to the O-V. I used to move snowflakes by the O-Z. I guess even back then you can call me CEO or the R-O-C.
Let's just start all over.
All right. Well, we are live. And good morning, Chris. And for my audience who don't know who this fine specimen of a gentleman is. Well, wow. Pause. That sounded very.
You are way too kind.
way too kind. No, but Chris, you guys might know him as Polarizing Chris from Instagram. He's one of my very good friends over the years. We commentated together back in the Live at the Bike poker days, which is now Live at Bally's. And Chris is quite possibly one of the funniest, most entertaining people and genuine people that I've ever met in my life. So, Chris, thank you for joining. And
thank you. Good morning.
Yeah. I appreciate that.
That was way too kind. I would disagree with literally everything you said. I think all of those are incredible inaccuracies. So I think we're now not being truthful. No. No, it's funny you mentioned Live at the Bike, because that just feels like such a long time ago now.
When I was getting ready for us to talk, and I tried to find some of the old Live at the Bike tapes that you and I were on and you and I were featured on. Mm-hmm. But I gotta say, there's still an Instagram clip where remember the Instagram Live at the Bike specials that we used to put together?
Of course.
Bro,
those were so much fun.
They were so much fun, right? And I actually played poker at the bike recently, and I walked past the Live at the Bike studio, and bro, just a big wave of nostalgia. All the memories, all the degeneracy, the friends, the networking.
What did they do with that room now? Is that like empty, or like, I mean, what's going on in there?
They put, I think they put pie gal tables in there.
Are you messing with me?
No. They put pie gal tables, and then but they left the Live at the Bike emblems,
logo, the graphics, right? They still have the graphics in there.
Oh yeah.
It's crazy. That's crazy. I thought maybe they would just make it like a private, like, oh, we're just gonna host private games in here, but they have a whole separate area for that. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. So they have a high limit private area. So I'm thinking, like, oh, they probably wouldn't do that. Right. So yeah, no, right. It's like, as much as like the fun that we had and all the memories, I was sad when they decided to sell it. And then it became Bally's, and then they sold it again. And now it's with Commerce. Commerce bought it. So now it's Live at the Commerce.
Right. That's right.
And I've watched it. I mean, it feels a lot like the old show, the old days, but it just has like more of a corporate feel to it. It doesn't have that like fun, you know, it's like they're trying to keep up with the Joneses now. And it's unfortunate, because to me, it lost a little bit of its luster. So.
Yeah. Well, I think when it's not about the people anymore and it's more about the production, which is fair. Right. But bro, when we were doing it, like we were, it's like one of the industries that was booming, but it was from the people for the people, you know, and when you and I were doing it, we were very relatable. It's not like we were Phil Ivey or Phil Hellmuth. We were just Chris Miles and Alan Catherman just trying to do something. You were Polarizing Chris. I was AK Poker. And that in of itself was pretty. And I think that's what created the Instagram poker boom is that people were just themselves. And that's what was getting popular. Is a lot more relatable. People can recognize that, hey, I can't afford a higher buy-in, so let me play a lower stake. hey, I've been in that situation where I get called by 6-4 offsuit on a 4-bet jam and I get fucking stacked.
And I mean, hey, speak for yourself. I was trying to be Bill Ivey when I was out there. Okay, I wanted to crush everyone at the table. Now, what most likely ended up happening was what you just described. You know, you'd go in with the pocket aces, and all of a sudden, guy gets cute with 6-4, and he stacks you, right? So, I mean, and that happened to me far more times on stream than I ever care to admit.
Yeah.
But you know, there was actually a hand that became famous for a while. It was me against aces, Ron, rest in peace. I had kings. I misplayed them terribly. And I mean, I played them about as horrible as you possibly can. And he had like 9-7, and the flop was a rainbow. He checks back. And what his reasoning for him betting the turn in the river was because I checked the flop. He thought, oh, this guy doesn't have anything either, and he probably won't have anything the rest of the hand. So when I started betting big, when he hit his 9, he's like, I'm not going anywhere. And then the 7 hits, his 2 pair just absolutely dominated me. I go all in thinking he's got squat, and he snapped. He couldn't get his chips in fast enough. Like, he couldn't call fast enough. And there's an image of me just absolutely agonizing. I lean back and I'm like, yeah, that was used as a meme for a little bit. So
I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah, because that picture was used for the future promos for the Life of the Bikes and all the Instagram lineups.
That was.
Oh my God. Yeah. And then I think one of my favorite ones is what was the meme? Something along the lines of when you're getting sucked off from below the table and you start to climax in the face you make.
Oh, that's right. I forgot about that one. Wow. That is nostalgia right there.
Yeah.
Oh, but man.
That was such a great time. I think playing on stream was one of the best experiences that I ever had playing poker, because like, you're going up there, everybody sees the cards that you're playing, you know, while you're playing, other people are watching you, and you're like, they know exactly what I'm, if I do something stupid, it's gonna for sure be all over the internet. And of course the Instagram, you know, or of course the poker people are very nice and not, you know, very cordial, and they don't ever talk shit about everything that you do because they're not perfect as well.
I was like, for you at home who don't know that is severe sarcasm.
Yeah. God. The
keyboard warriors would come out in full force on every little thing. And that's why when I was playing, I almost made it a point to do something stupid, because at least I got it out of the way.
I got it out of the way.
You know, like, bring on the heat, because I knew I was going to get it. So, yeah, no. And I would have friends text me afterwards, and they're like, yeah, there was a moment where I just knew you were going to do something stupid. And I was like, Chris, don't do it. And then you did it. And I was like, there he is. There he is. Yeah.
Nothing more I used to love than seeing all the critiques of how bad you quote unquote played. But then you go on that person's Instagram or you go on that person's page and they have like maybe a $50 chip stack on their thing, or man, look at how I ran it up, and they have maybe chip $200
That was a time. Someone was trying to bring that back.
The chip.
But they were trying to do it on like threads, like Instagram threads instead of like Twitter or Instagram. And I'm like, that's not quite the same thing. Like that's a weird place to do it.
Interesting. You know what? Speaking of which, though, what I love about that, and what about Live at the Bike, Chris, you used to have a segment called Poker Tip of the Day. And as a surprise, I didn't tell you I was going to do this, but I did. I actually gathered about 5 or 6 of my favorite ones that I did.
No.
And lucky for you, I have a phone. Hold up. Let me see if I can get this going.
Poker tip of the day. If you're going to call a 4-bet shove with 6-4 off, be prepared to get a dick punch when you suck out. I mean, I haven't seen that one in probably 3 years.
This episode is brought to you by humanwellnesscenters.com. With 60% of Americans having at least one chronic disease and 51 million Americans suffering from some kind of chronic pain, it's pretty clear that the westernized medicine's approach to healing and health by way of big pharma prescriptions and repetitive surgeries is what's keeping people sick. And the last thing you'd want to do is fall into this vicious cycle if you happen to have fallen ill or gotten hurt. So what is the solution, you might ask? Listen closely. Stem cell therapy, aka the super soldier serum. Stem cell therapy, also known as regenerative medicine, promotes the repair response of diseased, dysfunctional, and or injured tissue using stem cells and their derivatives. It is what I would call the AI approach towards your best future self. Visit my amigos at humanwellnesscenters.com. Use the code ShiftEQ10 and see what UFC fighters, professional athletes, and even bodybuilders are now using to repair, rejuvenate, and reconstruct their bodies to the best versions of their human selves.
Bro, I got more. That was one of my favorite. I'm gonna end with my favorite one, but I have at least
such great hair too. There, wow, bro, man, what
you still do, my man? What are you talking about?
Not like that, man. Oof.
Oh man, you know what? I find hilarious is when you rewatch something that you did in the past, and you feel like you look way better then than now. It kind of makes you feel like, man, I'm fucking losing it. Have I let myself?
I didn't say I look better, but I definitely had like just really nice hair. I just happened to notice in that particular clip. So
just the hair.
Everything else was a little. I was looking a little hefty there. I was a little thicker.
I feel like that's what we do though, right? We just accordion out based off of just over the years of what's going on in our respective lives, you know?
I mean, so. you nailed it, because at that time I was in a different relationship. I was extremely like unhappy, and I gained weight out of spite of my partner at the time. And she was like a quote unquote fitness model or trying to be in fitness modeling. And we hated each other. Like, we really resented each other. It was very unhealthy at the end. And it's so weird to see that video. And that's immediately what I thought about, was like, man, look how unhappy that I truly was. Even though I was funny and making content, and I was trying to find distractions, poker was one of those distractions for sure.
You know, one of the things that I've observed being in poker, especially start playing in more and more games, you start playing higher stakes, you start playing in different areas and certain private games that, you know, aren't in a casino. And the people that it draws in, you know, I've met famous athletes, I've met famous business owners, I've met famous actors, musicians, whole nine yards. And if there's one thing that I find about poker, is that a lot of people, regardless of where they're at in their lives or what they're masking, is they use poker as an outlet to get away from something, to escape their day to day, because something of that is drawing them to need a release, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it's interesting just to hear that from you, because I didn't, you know, I knew you were kind of going through something at that time, but I didn't know at the extent of what that was. I didn't know it was going to be at the point where if I play an old funny clip, that's kind of what that takes you back to. That's actually very interesting.
Well, it's like, I remember that apartment that I did it in, and she helped me move into that apartment at that. So it's just like, it was like one trigger after another trigger of like my memories, right? So it's like, I see that and I'm like, wow, I haven't been in that place in 5 years. You know, and it's like, wow, I have, you know, I moved into that in 2014, 2015. And I think that clip was from 2016, 2017 timeframe, somewhere around that range. Mm-hmm. So it's just wild to see that.
Man, I remember that one. You know what? I remember. Is it the one bedroom apartment that I think I was playing at the Gardens all night long, and then I ended up coming over and passing out on your couch or something like that?
That might be. I mean, I honestly don't remember. So like, that sounds about right. Yeah, it sounds about right.
I want to play on them. I want to play a couple more of these because they're freaking awesome.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's go.
Let's do this.
Today's poker tip of the day is on tilt. When going on tilt, make sure you get as fucking mad as possible. Splash your chips, punch the dealer in the face. It doesn't matter. Just make sure that everyone knows that you have a fucking anger problem. Oh man, that's funny.
Yo, those are great. Hilarious. Bro, I got it. That's too much. All right. I got at least three more.
So tip is on GTO versus exploitive play. If you always raise in position with ace queen suited, you're exploitable. If you four bet jam shove with 9-10 suited, well, that's GTO. that's actually the one I got like the most people DMing me saying that was the best way to explain what that is to normal people. That's probably one of my favorites. That might be one of my all-time favorites. That's so funny. I have not seen that in so long.
Nothing worse than stepping to a low buy-in table with a very low cap, like $100 max table or something like that, and someone sitting there explaining to you on how their moves or GTO are exploited.
It's like
you have four big blinds, bro. Shit.
Like, yeah. Why are you saying this? I could care less. As I get older too, like, and I've very much now understand the role that GTO plays in the game, because one, it's inescapable. You just can't, that's something that's changed, at least that I don't even really talk about that much. Even in like more recently, the content that I was producing before I had to take a little break, I got married. So there was a little break in my life where major life changes happened. But I started studying a lot more, and kind of what I was figuring out is it's not as daunting as I thought it would be. Places where it's digestible to learn a better, more efficient way to not just learn how to play better, but just to study better. Because that was something that I was lacking, and I didn't understand the right way to study. Everybody thinks like, oh, I'm just going to review hands and this is studying, but that's not really studying. It's really more about being honest with yourself and saying, hey, why did I make this move? Why did I raise here? And if I can't answer that question, then I'm not studying correctly. And that was something, this is not meant to be a plug, but I started studying more on BBZ Poker, their platform for their lessons, their daily sessions or whatever. It's incredible. And they come with all these resources that are included for free or whatever. Again, I'm not going to like plug their whole site, but one coach in particular has changed the way I think about the game. I thought I was thinking about it correctly, or at least like, oh, you do A, B, C, and you get D, right? Like, it was like, okay, I get this, right? There's a path. Brian Fight, which he used to have a site called Turbo Kings. Okay. And it was a small community. They were kind of changing the way people look at the game. And then like Michael Longcar, our good friend, introduced me to his lessons. He's like, hey, you got to check out the site. I'm learning stuff from him. It's changing the way I think about the game. And I started seeing his results. And obviously he's amazing player already. He's a crusher. He's a very consistent winner, but he was like, this has changed the way I think. And my results are getting better and my selection's getting better. So I was like, all right, I'll give this a shot. Jumped on, blown the first 30 minutes of him just talking. I was like, dude, this guy's one of us. He's one of us. Like the way he speaks, he's like, oh yeah, this guy's fucking donkey, and you could tell he's a donkey because of XYZ, and this is how we're going to exploit him. And I'm like, that's how I think, that's how I talk, this is great. So it was interesting. But anyways, to like kind of land the plane here, it's just now that I have those resources and I understand the right way to study, it's changed the way that I approach the game, and my results have gotten better significantly because of that. Even though, and I love playing live, I just don't have the time for it. So the transition of playing more online has been a big difference. So again, it's still very, like, I guess you could say part-time thing for me, but when I do have time, it's nice. So
yeah, the way I used to learn, used to review hands and then I would start studying. But what worked best for me, I think that once you understand GTO as, man, I'm not trying to nerd out too hard and I'm not trying to go too far into this, right? I feel like GTO is just a better way of saying there is an optimal way to play the most equitably as possible. You know that, like, under the gun, you shouldn't be raising like 4 or 5 suited or something like that, that you should be waiting towards later, that it can be a move depending on who's in the cutoff or who's whatever. Like, you know, there's a theory of things.
Yeah.
For me, what I've learned is to just kind of have a basic equitable approach and then adjust based off the table and based how the people are on the table. Sure, something says that you should call here, but if you've seen this guy playing over and over again and this is how he does something, you know, just trust. For me, I just trust my intuition in that aspect. And that's just kind of how I learned. And then another thing, I think you said it, you illustrated very, very beautifully, which is, why is it in this situation I keep calling off? Why is it in this situation I'm overfolding? And then it's like, you got to, you know, learn about yourself and have the humility to say, if I actually want to get better, I need to improve on the spot and see what it is about the spot that's not making me play right.
Totally.
And bro, that when I remember living in Vegas, man, the amount of times that I get, you know, punched in the dick, metaphorically speaking, from poker, you know, like I feel like you've never played poker seriously until you left the casino with like losing way more than you had ever anticipated. And just sitting there like, what the fuck did I do with my life and why? Right. Yeah. And then the very next day, waking up, you're like, I'm going to fucking do it all over again. You know, like, fuck.
I mean, you said it right there. You have to like getting punched in the dick. And if, you know, if you can't handle the bad days, and there's some bad days, then you really can't appreciate when it's going good. And that's, you know, right. that definitely changed kind of my perspective on things, because I've gone through roller coasters just like anybody else. But it was having that humility to say, like, you know what? I don't know shit. The game has changed. It changes a lot. Obviously, it's always evolving. It's always changing. There's new ways to think and look and do things. But there is now, I'm willing to accept, a more standardized approach in learning correctly. And, you know, depending on who you talk to, right? Some people are just like, I'm only GTO. I'm a freaking bot. I'm a nerd. And then now there's this other kind of side that I've been more exposed to, where they're like, we're going to take the fundamental principles of GTO, but we're not going to play like bots, because there's still a like room for exploitative play. And they combine the two. And that's, I guess, like the best people I can say probably do that is like Raise Your Edge. They're very notorious for that. They are like, hey, we understand GTO, but we also exploit people. Like, we do both. And if you're just doing one or the other, you're going to get crushed. And that's what I've seen. It's like, I was doing one or the other, and
I get you.
My results weren't that great. I would be a break-even player at best. So now it's like, I'm starting to see this evolution of like, oh, hey, like I'm not a total idiot. Like I can digest this stuff. 'Cause I thought I was a caveman. I was like, you know what? I don't understand all this stuff, and the range trainers and the freaking, you know, the Pio solver and the GTO wizard, like my head's hurting. Like it hurts. I mean, it was physically like, I'm probably just going to quit, because these people are just mentally more advanced than I am. That's not the case. I just didn't know how to learn correctly.
So. You know, and there's also, we talked about it at your wedding. I don't know if you're part of the conversation, because, well, it was your wedding. I don't know if you want to talk
about it. There was a lot of conversations happening.
That's true. we were talking about how there's this like new wave of Instagram poker players and all their little videos, all their reels. And I've noticed it at the casino as well, that even though I'm, what was 2000, so at least about like 8, 7, 9 years away from being as serious in poker as I used to be, there's still a lot of bad players. There's still people that, regardless of you speak, there's still a lot of people that don't know how to spell GTO. There's still a lot of people that, regardless of what you do, you're like, wow, you are the guy that's 4-bet jamming with 6-4 offsuit. And I think that's the beauty of the game, is that regardless of how advanced and how much material there is out there for people to get better, there's still people that are just gonna just be people and not be good, which is great. You know, it's phenomenal. And you know, just as much as you have the people that study, that have GTO, you know, solvers, exploitative, whatever conversation you want to get into, there's still people that are like, nah, I'm just gonna come here with the money that I just made from work, donk it off or make a lot and YOLO and go home. And that's okay. You know, the balance of having both kind of people in the industry is a phenomenal thing for sure.
So, no, I mean, it keeps the ecosystem alive, right? Like that is important. And I think that's something that the industry is starting to mature again. When I started playing back in 2007, 2006, it was very much like, hey, a good player doesn't talk about how great of a player he is. And even more importantly, he never talks about how bad another player is if they're there, because it's like, no, we need them in our ecosystem to survive. You know, without those players, one, it's not as fun. And two, it's a lot harder to make a profit. So it's always blown my mind when I see two people arguing at a table. It's like, you're such a bad player. You're an idiot. It's like, dude, shut up. Let him be a bad player. If this guy's having fun, if this person, if this guy or girl is having fun, let them have fun. There's nothing wrong. Yes, they got lucky. Does that mean they're going to do it 10 out of 10 times? Probably not. It's a low equity play. They're going to lose more times than they win, but let them have their win. Like, let them enjoy it. So I think that comes with maturity. That comes with experience playing for a long time and just understanding those spots where it's like, hey, I'm not going to get super tilted if my aces got cracked. That's what it felt like.
That's what it feels like, the irony. Oh my God.
I'm not going to get mad if my ass gets cracked.
Oh my God.
I'm not going to get upset if my aces get cracked. Like, yeah, I'll let it affect me for a second, and then you move on, right? So, totally. I mean, that's the beauty of it. Everyone thinks they're great, but only you know
what you know what the thing is too. That it's a huge microcosm of life. Is where like you think you're so deserving of a certain situation, and you can still lose, and that's just like one of the best lessons you can honestly get in your life. Like the amount of things I learned from two cards and betting every single street is just phenomenal on how other ways that it can, like, you know, one of the things that I learned best from poker is what, you know, based off of this hand, how do I want the outcome to be played out? And how do I play each street to get to that outcome? For example, if I have pocket asses, you know what I mean? And I don't want my pocket asses to get cracked. All right, in the pre-flop stage, I got to do something that bets big so that only, you know, it'll eliminate a lot of the lower hands so that when I play post-flop into the turn into the river, that makes it a lot easier. Those decisions become a lot better. All right, I end up flopping a pocket, you know, I flopped a set of asses. I'm going to just call it asses from here on out. So
it's now asses. It's now asses. I have to make a post that talks about having pocket asses.
Hey, don't worry. I'll cut this up into a reel, and then you'll be able to use that, and it'll be all right.
That's perfect. Right? People are like, where is that coming from?
So yeah, so the how, like, you know, like, all right. So if I want to have, you know, let's say I flop a set of pocket asses, if I want to have all the money and buy the river, how much do I need to bet on the flop? How much do I need to bet on the turn? Then what do I need to do to make it to the river? Okay. With that being said, if the board changes this, that, and the other, you know, it made me so much aware of how to create a strategy and then also have enough humility to pivot based on how everything ends up playing out. And the amount of times that I got dick punched or got my asses cracked because I didn't, you know, adhere to that, it's just pretty awesome. And then I've noticed that when I do things in my life now, I look at what's the outcome that I want. How do I work that towards that I'm doing now? And if things change in the middle, how do I pivot? And I feel I attribute that a lot to poker. Another thing I wanted to bring up, and actually this I'm going to play the next video is going to actually piggyback off of this. I think one of the best things that you did for poker is because you were so damn relatable. And just like what you said, you promoted people, just the regular person, the average just fan of poker, to go out there and play because they fucking loved it. And who gives a flying fuck if you're not a pro or if you don't know how to spell GTO? Like, at the end of the day, it's a fucking game. You know, at the end of the day, it's just there for fun, and it's just there for bantering and having a good time. And, you know, sure, you might be an 82 to 18 dog. Right? Like, you might be an 82% 18% dog, but that 18% hits 18 out of 100 times. And what's not to say that this is the one time it's going to fucking hit? Why the fuck not?
Right. You know?
And that's why. And to my audience here, this is what I'm talking about here on what I mean by how great Chris was for poker and for the community.
Oh, I didn't see you there.
I mean,
happy fuck off Friday, everybody. Since it is Friday, you know the drill. We're going to go ahead and leave work at noon.
My whole thinking,
we're going to send the kids off to the grandparents.
Started Instagram poker stuff was very much, I just wanted to connect with other players. That was it. I had no intention of creating content. There was zero intention. It was, I want to go ahead and meet other players and learn from them and just hang out.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. Oh, wait, I got to play this video real quick because I want people to see that. This is great. This is great. Let me know.
Oh, I didn't see you there. Happy Fuck Off Friday, everybody. And since it is Friday, you know the drill. We're going to go ahead and leave work at noon. We're going to send the kids off to the grandparents. And we're going to let our significant other know that we're not going to be home for a few days. Because we're driving to the casino. And we're dumping our entire paycheck on that table. And then we're going to drive home with a bruised ego and a DUI on the record. Let's play some fucking cards.
Oh, man, did you not see that? I can tell my
facial expression. No, it said it failed.
Oh, no.
I didn't see any of that.
Oh, my God. It was the one where you're like, hey, this happy fuck off Friday. We're going to take our paychecks, go to the casino, leave with bruised egos and a DUI.
I mean, the inspiration for that literally came where I was sitting on the couch and I was like, you know what? For a lot of people, this is payday. And what's the first, when I was first playing, the first thing I want to do is literally rush to the casino. Most people are like, oh, I'm going to go out drinks with friends. I'm going to go and maybe go and take someone on a date or whatever, right? That was not how I was thinking. I was so obsessed with the game. I was like, I can't wait to get in my car, sit in about 40 minutes of traffic, go to a valet that's overpriced. And at the time, I couldn't afford the valet. So you're parking in the very back of the parking lot, right? At the gardens or the bike. You're hiking to the front. Security pats you down because you look like a terrorist. And then you walk inside and all you hear is plastic chips or those weird clay chips. All it was like a symphony. You walk in and it's like, I'm getting chills talking about it right now. I just walk in and you hear those chips clacking from about 150 tables. And I literally would look at a friend of mine. Didn't matter who I was with. Most of the time I was alone. But I'd bring a friend. I'd look over and I was like, welcome to Flavor Country. like this. That's what it felt like. It felt like I've just arrived in heaven. You know?
Right.
It didn't matter if the night went good or not. That moment of when you first walk in after a long week and you sit down at a table and you get your chips handed to you for the first time. That's
right.
If they could bottle that, I'd be a billionaire.
And then what sucks is then you get stacked on your very first hand. And you're like, why the fuck did I do this?
Okay. I've got a story. Okay. I've got a story for you. I've got one of the best stories. It's about our friend Dylan.
Oh God.
we're in Vegas. Okay. I want to say it's near, this is like 2010, 2011 time frame, somewhere in that range. We drove to Vegas. We were meeting up with these girls. He was trying to date or hook up with some girl. And we get there, and I'll never forget this. We were staying at MGM, and we hadn't even checked into our room. He's pulling out cash out of his pocket. He's like, I have to play right now. He runs to the table. Okay, he runs to the table, sits down. It's a 1-2 table, I think, at the time. It was a 1-2 or 2-5. I can't totally remember. MGM. And it was before they had, like, made poker a big deal there. Because, I mean, there was a long time where it was just like, oh, yeah, we got a few tables. And so, and it was in the middle of the casino. And had, like, a weird little, like, apparatus for lights to, like, illuminate the tables. But it was in a weird spot. He sits down. We're, like, the girls come walking up to us. So we're, like, talking to him. Our friend Jesse's with us. I'm talking to Jesse. And it was like all of a sudden, all I hear is like, damn it. Are you kidding me? And then I look and I go, wait, did he even get his chips? Like, he never got his chips yet. But he has a hand. Like, wait, we've only been here like 45 seconds, maybe a minute. And we don't know what's really happening because we're like trying to carry the conversation. We're like, okay, that's Dylan just being Dylan. We look over and the chip runner comes walking up. It's like, okay, sir. And the dealer goes, uh-uh. Those all go to the gentleman in seat 9. And they put the chip and they go, and they shift the whole stack of chips. So he literally went all in on his first hand with no chips. So the whole rest of the trip, we kept staying all in with no chips. We're like, oh, at least you're not going all in with no chips. And that joke lasted, I want to say, for about 3 years. We tormented him with that.
Oh, my
God. We're like, oh, let's like be careful this time. Let's not go all in with no chips. Right? But I was like, I didn't even know that was possible. He got dealt in. Right? They said he was 300 behind. He's having to announce his raises. He's like, Ray's 125. I got 275 behind. Right. And he was like saying this, and and the dealer has to keep track, right? The dealer was amazing because as like calm as she could be, it was a woman, as calm as she could be, she goes, no, not him, seat nine, just, and takes his chips and slams it on the dude's side of the table. And you just see Dylan like holding it, and he's like thinking about like, maybe I shouldn't have played the very first hand, you know, because he was already down an entire buy-in and we'd been there not even 90, like, I want to say we were there maybe 5 minutes.
Oh no. And not to mention now the rest of the session or the rest of Vegas is about coming out of that hole that you just dug yourself in from the beginning, right?
Oh yeah. No, and then he just proceeded to get sloshed, as we all did, because he was super upset. I think he went and started playing random games like craps and roulette, and it's like, oh, I'm gonna chase these losses, we'll be fine, like I'll make it all back. But it just, I'll never forget that as long as I live. We weren't even there. God. We weren't even there 5 minutes. He couldn't wait to sit down at a table. He couldn't wait to play the first hand. He couldn't wait to go all in. And of course, losing all of it in the very first, like before the chips even come out. I mean, that's it's iconic. I'll never forget that.
Man. You know what? That reminds me of all of the fun WSOP moments that we had, to kind of piggyback off of your saying about community, about in networking and meeting people, because you and I have met a lot of phenomenal people in the space of poker and a lot of phenomenal degenerates, right? To add on to that, the degenerate ass stories.
Yep.
When we're talking about WSOP, we're talking about funny, memorable moments. What are some of the ones that stick out to you like during those years?
I would say there's a few memories.
Okay.
One that immediately pops into my head is some of the times where we were all sitting together at a table at a random card room. Cause as you know, and maybe your audience knows or doesn't know this, for people who are non-poker fanatic degenerates like ourselves, the WSOP turns Vegas into a giant poker, like home game. I mean, the best way I could describe it is there's so many games going on at so many different properties. Yes, a lot of them are going to be wherever the World Series is, which now it's transitioned to the Horseshoe in Paris. But before that, when it was at the Rio, people didn't like going to the Rio because it was off the strip. So a lot of games would happen on the strip, Aria, Venetian, places like that. I'll never forget. There's two instances where we went to literally random card rooms, probably the worst places you can go and play cards, the Flamingo and the Orleans. Okay. Yeah. Okay. We convinced the Flamingo to spread a 1-2 PLO game that they said they hadn't ran since the 80s. Okay. We convinced them to run it. And then all of a sudden, because of me and a few other players, I couldn't remember everyone who was there. I want to say Stu was there, Chad, like some of our usual suspects, Mark Basali. We got all these people together and we just took over a table. Next thing we know, we look at the waiting list and there's a 30-person wait list to get into our game.
Wow.
Because if you saw how crazy this was, there was just pots. I mean, we're playing 1-2. There's $500 and $800 pots just every hand. Moving around the table. I mean, it was absolute chaos. We're taking stories, you know, we're recording, and it's just, I mean, we're cracking jokes. It was the most fun that I've had. The second most fun I had too was at the Orleans, and we're playing a stupid 4-8 limit PLO
game. I remember that. Okay.
And we all bought in for like $2,000 or $3,000, like assholes. They stacks, the dumbest, most obscene large stacks of chips in front of all of us. And what the funniest part is, I think I wasn't even trying to play, and I ended up leaving $500. And I to tell you how hard that is in a 4-8 limit game when you're only, like, we were playing every hand, and I just happened to be getting smacked with monsters every single time.
I
think Brian was the biggest loser. He's like, dude, I lost $300 playing this bullshit game. And like, but we were having the time of our lives. None of us really even thought about it.
It was. You know? It was.
Those are some of the memories that I have, it had nothing to do with like the World Series, so to speak. It right. was the atmosphere there is sick. I mean, they do it big and it's fun and it's great. You know, every regular person can feel like a professional athlete or a celebrity, right? Especially when you're playing in a major tournament, you make a final table. I mean, everyone's going to know who you are. But the camaraderie with you guys, that's the memory that sticks out the most. Because that honestly is the whole reason I wanted to play anyways.
Yeah. Dude, I still remember that, that Orleans 4-8 limit game where the reason why our chips look so huge is because you can only play with $1 chips. So we can do like other chip denominations. Like, no, we all want $1 chips.
You want to color up? Absolutely not.
Absolutely not. No, I want this. And then, yeah, just to add on to the point of the Flamingo, the Orleans list for that table got freaking like 30, 40 people huge. And I remember we were saving spots for some of our friends and the old ladies and old guys that were trying to play at the table were complaining that we're saving them. Like, look, if you don't let this guy play, if you don't hold the seat from him, we are all going to leave. AKA the whole reason the game's why over. This game be right. The game is, and then you got these people when we're buying in for $2,000 to $3,000 at a time. You have these people buying it for $20 at a time and trying to get into the game. Like, no, I deserve to be here. Like, bro, we did this for fun. We didn't do this to actually create the table.
That's what was so cool about it, because we got to make these what otherwise would be like a private game public and get people excited about it. And this was like before I even knew what an influencer truly was. You know, because after that, and you were talking about how different Instagram is with poker content and gambling in general, which I don't want to say any companies yet, but I've been approached by some very large companies more recently about promoting online casinos. And when we're talking numbers, I'm like, I only have 3,500 followers. You want to pay me how much per post? Like, that doesn't not make any bad. Sense. They're like, oh, we're going to limit you to like one or two posts a week. Fuck, I'll post every day. You're going to pay me this? I'll post every day. They're like, no, it doesn't work like that. I'm like, well, then like, I'm not interested. Right. But they see the opportunity in that. Right. Like, they're like, right. they were naming names. They're like, we're partnered with this person, you know, and this person, you know, and you know, and I'm like, really? And I'd like hit them up. Hey, are you like talking with so-and-so? And they're like, oh yeah. Like I'm posting and yeah, it's legit. And they're paying me. I'm like, how did I not realize? I wasn't smart enough back then to realize it, which is really funny because I come from a sales and marketing and business background. And I just didn't, again, I didn't do this for the notoriety or the money or the fame. It was all about having fun. It was about connecting with other players and then promoting the game organically. And I think that's what's so special about like our circle of friends, our people that we've all connected with through the game and through Instagram, is we all just enjoy the game. We enjoy some played professionally, some played as a hobby, some did a mix of both. But the whole point was that when we all got together, we'd play cards, but it wasn't really about cards. You know, we became really close. And I mean, you guys were all at my wedding. I can't tell you how much that meant to me. Like it's Ashley, my wife, was mentioning it to me. She goes, like, you're so lucky to have so many people in your life that truly care about you and about us. And it's like, I think it's like, well, it had to be reciprocated. Like, I truly care about every person in the room here. Like there wasn't, you know, like you go to a wedding and you're like, why'd they invite so-and-so? They hate that person. That was not, that was not my wedding. Everyone who showed up was everyone who I truly love and care about and wanted to be there. And so, you know, people were meeting each other for the first time. And it's like, there's a lot of people who don't know my poker, sports, gambling friend. You know what I mean? Like, they're like, who are these guys? And they're so funny and they're so charming. And I'm like, yeah, they're just on a good one. No, it's like, but like, it's like, yeah, I mean, that's what happens when you're at an open bar at a wedding. No, everyone's really charming. But it was really, it just meant a lot to me. And like over the years, I cherished those types of relationships so much more, because obviously the longer that we know each other, the deeper our bond grows. And even like, you know, you and I, we haven't had a chance to connect all that much as frequently as we used to, but it's like, how often when you and I reach out to each other and it's like, we never left. It's just like, we're right back where we were, you know, maybe we've grown as men and evolved as people and things like that. But at the end of the day, it's like, I know why you and I get along. It's because we have a lot of the same values. We care about a lot of the same things, and you know, we're good people. And that's what I like to surround myself with, good people. So in poker, there's a lot of shitty people in the game. There's a lot of bad people, but I think that's why I'm even more lucky, is I feel like I got to be around the good ones and meet a lot of the good ones.
Yeah. And also I think being, well, first of all, I have a couple of things to add to that. First one being, the reason why there are so many phenomenal people that supported you at your wedding is because it's just a reflection of you, right? Chris, you're a phenomenal person I fucking love dearly, and I could say that proudly. And I know that if it wasn't for who you are as a person, just with who you are naturally as your morals, your values, your integrity as a person, like those kind of people wouldn't be around you if you didn't, if you weren't a reflection of that in of itself, right? I think the second thing too is, I think poker presents you with so many people and so many people going through their own certain things. And when gambling is the main medium for which people connect over, it can bring about a lot of different characters, and definitely a lot of conniving ones, definitely a lot of backstabbers. And I think that when you start going through and meeting all these different people, you have to learn how to adapt and filter out some of those people that you are going to network with or connect with. I mean, the amount of people that I've had to cut off in poker because it was A, going to cost me a lot of money, B, is going to cost me trust issues or whatever. It's pretty crazy, right? And I think after a while of being able to filter some people out of your life, or filter a lot of people out of your life, and you see the same people still there that meet the requirements of that filter, it's priceless. You know, we all started over Instagram, over poker. Then we had like a group chat that never died, which I'm not going to go into the details of that group chat for the sake of that group chat. But there's definitely
we started group chats. Like all these memes about like, oh, if the group chat ever leaked, I'm like, no, that's us. Like we started that 7 years ago, 8 years ago. Like that's us.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Legendary
group chat. It's I hate to say it, but the enemy of an enemy is a friend, and we all have the same kind of certain people that we're just kind of making fun of. Like
it's so ridiculous, but you're so right. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah,
honestly brought us closer together. That's so stupid, but oh my god.
Well, I mean, you know, I think we all share the same value of being against people that are fake online, that try to pretend that they are something, or they try to act like whatever. And those particular people that we were constantly talking, we're just literally calling them out for things that they were doing. Like, you know, trying to start Jowl Poker and try to start that online heist of a ripoff of poker. And when people are being skeptical because they question the integrity of the system, and then you make it about, you know, not you particularly, but that person that we're talking about makes it about people being jealous of his quote unquote success. You know?
It's like you're making this too easy. You're a meme of yourself. Like this is getting to be, it's, you know, to kind of like go along that line. Like that's why I feel so fortunate about the people that I've met, because there are scumbags, there are people who unfortunately scam people, and it does put a really ugly black eye in the game. And no one's immune to it. I mean, some of the biggest high stakes pros, right? Some of the biggest names in the game have been caught or busted for crap. And it's sad because it puts it in this light of like, well, this is why it's not legalized in all 50 states and so on and so forth. But I think to me, and not to take this a little off topic, but I feel like the acceptance and the broad marketing of sports betting is going to eventually trickle down into poker. It has to. There's to me, we're close to another boom. We're close to this becoming a more accepted thing again. When we were growing up, ESPN, those reruns, 2004, 2003, all the way to 20, how long did they have it? Till 2020, 2021 or whatever, before it moved to CBS. I mean, that those early episodes of Moneymaker, it's iconic. It's what got all of us into the game. We loved watching all the celebrities, right? You know, Greg Raymer, Fossil Man with the freaking glasses, right? And right. Everyone had to go and get those glasses. And it's like, dude, what are you doing? You're a clone. Like, what's wrong with you? But it the personality was there, right? We didn't. Mm-hmm. But then you got to see the ugly side, right? You saw the guys that went too far, went broke, got into drugs, made bad decisions, and those things. And, you know, but then there was the opposite. Then you saw people who like took those opportunities and became an even bigger celebrity, like a Daniel Negreanu or a Phil Ivey, right? They're like, well, I mean, Phil Ivey might not be the best example just because he's just a complete maniac degenerate like all of us. But, you know, like, but he's a big name, right? And
right.
He's a Hall of Famer. He's a legend of the game. Negreanu is one of those people who are also just a legend. They've promoted the game the right way for so many years. And he was one of the first high profile people to humble himself and say, hey, you know what? Even though I've been playing this game my whole life, these young kids are better than me. And I want to know why. I want to find out how to become like them, where the game's just automatic. I respected that. Anyways, the whole point I was getting at, though, is that I feel like now that sports gambling is becoming more acceptable, more mainstream. I mean, it's everywhere. ESPN Bet. Are you kidding me? never in a million years.
I never thought it would be a thing.
Okay. They said for years, we're never going to promote gambling. We're never going to promote. This is not acceptable. People lose their families and houses over this. Now it's like, ESPNbet.com, you know, halftime show brought to you by ESPN Bet. Oh, and then here's our pregame show. It's DraftKings. And oh, here we go. Here's FanDuel. Like, it's so much more acceptable. But then we see the opposite side of it. You have athletes getting busted for gambling. And they're going, well, how could this happen? You promoted it on every channel for the last 6 months, right? I feel like poker's going to have that moment. I don't know when. I've been talking about it for about 4 years now. I thought COVID was going to be that kind of propelling people back into online poker. They didn't make it legal. So I thought that was interesting. And people are going to argue it's quasi-legal. You have the clubs and you have the whatever. It's legal in Vegas and New Jersey and whatever. But until it's legal in all 50 states, it's never going to be mainstream like it was. It just, it's not, you know, the sponsors are now tech companies, not Milwaukee's Best. Or Bud Light, you know what I mean? Like, we're not getting the NASCAR sponsorships. We're getting the tech nerd sponsorships, right? Like, oh, WSOP brought to you by GTO Wizard, but don't use it at the table. Don't use it at the table, but we're going to promote it. But it's cheating if you use it. It's like,
yeah,
what? Like, no, give me back my Jack's Beef Jerky Links sponsorship, okay? Give me my Jack's All Moment, and I'm happy, right? I think. What also needs to come back is just relating to the everyday person. Because right now it's not. It very much looks like a bunch of chess nerds at a table battling each other without speaking. It's very odd.
That I used to hate that when I was, because I used to play at the Wynn all the time when I lived in Vegas. And you'd have the sunglasses, headphones, hoodie pro that would sit at the table. Everybody's having shots. Everybody is having fun conversations. And the guy is just a complete hermit and a big introvert. And then when you tell him to speak, because it's ruining the vibe of the table, he just, get all whatever. And then it just like, it ruins the game. And I wish more grinders would. I haven't been in Vegas like that for years. So I don't know what it's like. I don't know if grinders are still the same, but I would hope that by now they've evolved and understand that like you have to, not only are you playing a game of poker, but you have to play the game of poker, of the cultural aspect that poker presents. Like, you know, if you want a tourist to be happy to dunk off a couple of $100 to you on a 6-4 offsuit and a 4-bet pot, like you have to make it worth his while. You have to make it so that he has a fun time doing it, you know? And then also with that being said, while you make it a fun time for him, you got to also lose with grace. You got to win with grace. You have to do all these things. And
Yeah, I mean, that's why I think playing poker professionally can be very hard, because it's not only about money, money management, but also how do you create the scenario for people to want to gamble to you and want to gamble with you without you being a complete fucking dick, you know? Like, it's
and I get it. It's hard sometimes, PB. Maybe you're having a bad day, or you're you know, and you're an introvert, which I think is, you know, it's the perfect game for an introvert, because typically you're not talking a lot, right? Like, right. If you're talking about the serious part of the game, you're in a tournament, nobody's talking. You're trying to kill that person. You know what I mean? Right. Like, you're keeping me from my money. So why the fuck would I talk to you? But so I get that. But to our, what we're talking about, our poker is a social game. Social game. It's meant to be enjoyed with human beings, not robots, not GTO freaking solvers. It's a game with human people, with human emotion and thought. And that's what always attracted to me the game. That's why I'm seeing this big wave of chess players coming into the game, because they're looking, they're going, wait a minute, I can make way more money with the same kind of study and effort. Why didn't I pick this up sooner? And now they're getting these major sponsorships with poker sites. And it makes all the sense. They're already hyper intelligent from chess. Right. And I've always loved chess. I'm terrible at it, but I've always loved it. I've always respected people who are really, really good at chess. And it does translate, because that same strategic thinking, planning ahead, three moves ahead, blah, blah, blah. But what changes is a lot of them will say the same thing. I didn't realize how much more math was involved, where it matters. And then at the same time, it doesn't matter at all. And then it's about reading the person in front of you, right? In a live setting. The people who play purely online, it's different, right? You pick up tendencies and all that stuff, but you're basically just playing the statistics. You're playing the math-based plays. That's fine, and that works, but again, it gets boring. You know, it becomes a grind. It becomes routine. So I'm always going to be a live player more than I'm ever an online player. I could go out and win $1 million online. It doesn't matter. I'm a live player. I love sitting at a table with people, chips in front of me, cards being dealt, that nothing replaces that. It's the best feeling in the world.
Yeah, I still love the game. Definitely love poker. And and I feel at a table, like, a part of poker is a social aspect. So you get to connect with people, you get to talk with people. And then also, I think there's just an inherent feel of live play that you can't get online. Like, you can only pay attention to so much, you know, online, like, oh, this guy's doing this kind of bet sizing. And you also don't know if you're playing against a solver. But if you're playing live, you're like, man, this guy kind of twitched when he raised right there. Like, huh, this guy kind of giggled and all of a sudden became really quiet with his hand out of nowhere. And speaking of which, bro, I had this moment where this guy tried to angle me and I ended up freaking stacking him, right? This is just great. So and here we are now. I never thought I was gonna be on a podcast talking about hand history and shit like that, but this is just this is fucking worth it to me.
Me either.
Yeah, but this is worth it, right? For me. So I'm opening with pocket nines, right? And it folds all the way to the blind. And then this guy, like, Hezzy calls and then raises out of nowhere. And I'm like, that doesn't look right. And then he tries to make it look suspicious. Like, he just starts looking around, doesn't do anything. And all of a sudden I'm like, dealer, is that right? And he goes, no. I'm like, and I look at him, I'm like, bro, if you're fucking angling me, this is really fucked up and stupid, by the way. Right. So fucking, they just leave him as a call. Flop is like queen nine something. So I end up flopping a set. This guy bets into me. I call. Turn is another card. He bets huge. I raise. He calls. Right. River is another three. And then he fucking, like, and it goes all in, right? Just jams, and I snap call, of course, right? And this guy, of course, has fucking pocket aces. And I fucking, and he, not only does he have pocket aces, but he fucking slow rolls me, thinking that he won. And I fucking flip over my hand immediately. Man. And it was just so funny, because I'm just sitting there, I'm like, this is what you get, fuck you. And I flipped over my set, and he goes, oh, what the fuck? I'm like, that's what you fucking get. And like, everybody at the table,
he couldn't believe it. Aces aren't supposed to lose.
Right. Moved. He got his asses cracked.
His asses cracked.
But it's funny just to like in those moments in live play, you won't be able to appreciate on an online something just because you won't see the people trying to fucking angle you, try to make you feel like you're an idiot or try to whatever. And it's like, this is what you fucking get. That's right. Fuck you and fuck you harder. Even that.
I will say playing online, you can very much get up and celebrate like a blubbering idiot when you win a hand you shouldn't have. Especially in a tournament where you're like, okay, I'm down to my last eight bigs, and you shove with a very mediocre hand, and then you suck out on the guy and you double up and you're like, yes, oh my God, I'm the best in the world. Like, I mean, that's how it feels. But you can't do that in a live setting. You freaking you'll get a timeout. You'll get kicked off the table online in your own room or whatever. You can, and I mean, of course, you know, I'm playing in my underwear. I've got a freaking meal. I'm like snacking, like that's the best environment. That's to me, I now understand the appeal of playing online because you can control your environment, right? And you can be as comfortable as you want, you know, got a nice chair, have a sick setup, right? You can't do that in a live setting. Those chairs and tables are terrible. There's people sneezing on you. It's just gross.
Right. And to add on to that, when you play online, you can also rage tilt when you fucking get your your asses cracked from six more off.
Yes. You can say things. You can say things you can't say anywhere else.
Right.
Absolutely.
Like, online. I mean, of course, in real life, you're just like throwing all your furniture around, like throwing the fucking cat at the refrigerator. Right. But on live chat, you're just like, good hand.
Yeah.
Like, nice hand, yeah. Bro. NH. Good job.
NH. Nice. That's exactly what happens.
GG. Exactly, you know what I mean?
So ridiculous. Oh man.
Oh man. So are you going to be doing anything WSOP wise this year or anything?
I'm glad you brought that up. I got to talk with the family, but yes, I very much was planning on going out there. I have not been out there since they moved it to, at the time it was Bally's and Paris. Now it's Horseshoe and Paris. I went there. We did our honeymoon. We did a mini honeymoon out there and got to walk around the Horseshoe, played at the Horseshoe, played a cash game till way too late with the wife, literally like, oh yeah, another daiquiri or whatever. You know, and it's like, it's interesting the way they have it set up there, because it's obviously just built for any other time that's not WSOP. It's just a very small room at the Horseshoe. But I'm very much looking forward to seeing what it's like, the atmosphere, you know, running into all the usual suspects. It's a big summer camp. Everybody sees each other from all over the country for the, you know, what, it's 5 weeks, 6 weeks it goes on. So, you know, I don't know if I'm going to be playing any events. I don't know if I have that kind of time. My job, my career now, it's I work remote. I'm a remote employee, right? Everybody hates that. Oh, you're a remote employee. It must be the greatest thing ever. I mean, it is. But at the same time, it's like, I still have to work. And if I'm going to work from a hotel room, I better have a, you know, I better have a enough time to get set up and everything. So, but yeah, I definitely plan on going out there, visiting, shooting some content. I think that's kind of a strategy. I've taken a break because I really want to plan and have the right kind of ideas put down. And I mean, WSOP is going to be the best place to do that. So probably somewhere towards middle to end of June is where I'm looking right now.
Okay. All right. And I hope you do get on the more content. And by the way, Chris, I need to play this one, like, cause this is my favorite one that you have so far. I hope it works for you. So to add on the content thing, let's hope this works.
Today's poker tip of the day: start reading the dictionary before you go out and play next session. So when an idiot scoops a massive pot off of you with 6-4 offsuit, you can call him a didactic hemorrhoidal fucktard. Nothing tilts more than a high vocabulary.
Oh man, I wow. I think I did look up the dictionary for that. Like, I legitimately opened a thesaurus and a dictionary and like was like, what's the worst thing you can call somebody?
Right. I mean, I got to tell you, Chris, you're one of the few people that can make a bigger impact in poker just by being yourself than winning any other tournament or winning a bracelet would ever do for you. Now, mind you, I hope they both happen, right? I hope you end up winning a bracelet one day and then also being able to use that. And But I got to definitely say, man, you have such a gift. You have a very good, you know, amazing talent. And just by being who you are, being charismatic, being able to connect, and I could definitely say I'm very, very proud to call you a friend, and more than happy that we're still on this this still kind of a journey together in that aspect, you know.
The feeling is mutual, my friend. I love you. I care about you, and I'm happy to see this podcast. I mean, I remember when you were just talking about starting a podcast. You're like, I'm going to do this thing, and I'm nervous about it, but I'm excited about it, and I don't know how it's going to go, but I'm going to give it everything I got. And I thought, he gives this thing everything he's got, it's going to be successful. There's no way it's not. That.
Appreciate that. Yeah. And I, you know what? And that's another thing I wanted to add to you real quick before we wrap this up. I definitely wanted for us to, I wish we would have connected.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho. H to the OV. I used to move snowflakes by the OC. I guess even back then you can call me CEO or the ROC.
Hey, if Barstool can still have some of their shows that are absolutely outrageous, I think we're tame compared to some of the stuff that I've seen. But yeah, I mean, it just depends. We're nobodies, right? They're like all huge celebrities. They could probably get away with a lot more shit than most people. So,
right. That's why we would have got canceled, right?
Because that's we're why we would have got canceled. Where are these guys? For sure.
All right, buddy. Well, hey, man, I appreciate you you coming on, and then just stay on for a little bit. For everybody that wants to follow Chris on Instagram, he's Polarizing Chris. And if you are ever want to be entertained by the game of poker, he's definitely your man for sure. But yeah, stay on for a little bit, man. And until next time, guys, I hope you guys have a great one. Deuce.
Thank you. See you guys.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho. H to the OV. I used to move snowflakes by the OZ. I guess even back then you can call me CEO or the R.